Hi, and welcome to this introduction to SolidWorks 2014. In this video, we'll cover the SolidWorks user interface, give you an idea of how to navigate, and hopefully cover some pitfalls that many new learners of SolidWorks fall into. SolidWorks is a parametric 3D modeler. What does this mean? Essentially, this means that we build parts in three dimensions from the very beginning in SolidWorks. Rather than traditional drafting techniques where 2D representations are used to construct parts, in SolidWorks we start with three-dimensional objects and then create two-dimensional drawings from those objects. It sounds confusing, but as we go along, I think it'll make a lot of sense. In this video, we want to show you how to use the SolidWorks interface. There are tons of icons, menus, buttons to push in SolidWorks. However, if you get used to a few basic rules of how SolidWorks intends for you to use the software, it should be a lot easier to navigate. When you open up SolidWorks, this is the view you will be presented with. You can see at the top there's some icons that we're used to, a new icon, open, and there's also a few menu icons. These menu icons are typically hidden behind this arrow. You can see when I mouse over the arrow, the menus appear. I like to leave them viewable, so I click on the little thumbtack and that will make them viewable. That thumbtack trick is going to come in very handy. You can see if I mouse over to the right where there are these menus, there's another thumbtack here that will pin them down to the interface. I do not find the ones on the right panel as useful, and so I'm going to go ahead and leave that untacked so that they go away and I have a larger workspace. Speaking of that right panel, though, you can see this design library and home. If you click on the home button, you can see there's a few getting started tips that you'll find helpful, particularly this introduction to SolidWorks. If you click on that, it opens up a PDF file for you that is an introduction to the SolidWorks user interface. I recommend that you read Chapter 1. That is the concepts that we will be covering today in this video. There's a plethora of other resources here, including tutorials, curriculums, and so on. For now, though, let's go ahead and jump into a new document. By clicking on the new document icon, you can see that a dialog box pops up. In this dialog box, there are three different types of files you can create in SolidWorks. There are part files, assembly files, and drawing files. The basic building block of all of these is the part file. Assemblies are created by combining different part files into one assembly. You can think of this as if you were playing the game of Jenga. If you had one block, that would be one part, but to build the entire tower, you would need all the different blocks to put it together. That would be in an assembly. A drawing, then, is taking that three-dimensional part and turning it into a 2D print that we can print on paper and send to a machinist or keep for our own records. Drawings in SolidWorks are always created based off of parts. So if you change anything in your part, it will automatically update the drawing. This is a very, very powerful feature of SolidWorks that you will come to appreciate over time. On the right, you see a large button for tutorials. There are many tutorials in SolidWorks that cover in-depth topics. We'll start off by doing a few tutorials, but for now we just want to look at the interface. A quick note about this dialog box. Sometimes the advanced button has been pushed. When advanced is pushed, it takes you to a more icon-driven menu. You can set up different templates and different tutorials within SolidWorks. We'll look at this later, but for now, go ahead and click back to Novice and click on Part. When you start a part, there are several different areas of the workspace that you need to be familiar with. The main window is called the graphics area or graphics window. This is where we will create sketches and build three-dimensional parts. The tools to do that are housed in the toolbar across the top. The toolbars are often called the command manager. You can see that they are tabbed, and they collect different types of tools that are similar into different tabs. For instance, my sketching tools are all in the Sketch tab. The Features tools, which actually build three-dimensional parts, are in the Features tab. Also note that many of my feature tools are currently grayed out. This means that they're currently not available until I create some geometry using my sketch tools. Again, this area across the top is called the Command Manager. The window where you actually build parts is called the Graphics area. And on the left, we have a Context Manager. This pane on the left changes what it's doing depending on where you're at. That's very difficult for some students to get used to, but a very important concept. Right now, it's showing me the feature tree. As you build parts, SolidWorks will keep track of how those parts are built and will catalog each step you take in the feature tree on the left. You can then go back and change features if you want. When you're actually building a feature, you'll see that this changes to be a feature manager instead of the feature history tree. Sound confusing? Let's go ahead and open a part that I've already created that will help clarify this for us. I can click on my open icon, and I'm going to come down to skid steer hole. This is a simple little part that I've created. It's a skid steer toy that I made for my son. You can see I can spin the part around. How am I doing this? I'm holding down the scroll wheel on the mouse and moving the mouse around. That causes our parts to rotate in three-dimensional space. You'll have an opportunity to try this in just a moment. All right, so in my graphics area, there's several things going on there. If we look on the left, you can see my feature history is quite long. It took a ton of different steps to build this part. But if we go back, you can grab, if you go to the very bottom of the feature tree, see how my icon, my arrow turns into a hand? I can roll back the part to the very beginning. And you can see I started this part with a very simple brick. And then I slowly added on to that brick and shaped it to build my skid steer. Okay. Let me go all the way back to current. Okay. You can also see that each one of these features, this boss extrude, we can take a look and we can see that a feature also has a sketch associated with it. Maybe I want to change how my skid steer started, and so I can go ahead and click on that sketch. Notice that a context toolbar or flyout menu appears as soon as I click on it. It gives me several different options. Normal to changes the graphics window to be normal to the original sketch. If I click it again, you can see I can change and edit the sketch. And you can see the sketch was a very simple rectangle that was 4 inches by 6 inches. All right. Now maybe I decide that I don't want to do this anymore and I actually want to go back and I want to look at Cut Extrude 5 and I try and click on it over here in the history tree. It will not allow me to do this. This can be really frustrating to students. I first have to exit the sketch. How can I tell I'm in a sketch? See this, these two red arrows in the middle? Those are called the origin. Anytime you see the origin, it means that you are in a sketch. To leave the sketch, I can either come up here and click the red X, which will say exit the sketch without keeping changes, or the blue purple arrow, which says leave the sketch and keep the changes. Now notice I can come down here and I can click another place. My context toolbar flyout comes up, and I can edit that sketch or edit the feature. This time, let's go ahead and edit the feature. Note what happened over here in my manager pane. It changed from being the feature history to being a property manager. This is the property manager for an extrusion. You can see here that this is where I made a little cross member on my skid steer. There are a bunch of different settings for this, including how thick I made that. I can grab that arrow and make it thicker, or I can come over here in the feature manager and set the thickness that I want it to be. In this case, I'll leave it at my 0.25 inches. I can also change the direction of the extrusion. I can change its ending condition. I can do all sorts of different things here. We'll worry about the details of this later. What's important for you to remember right now is to note that my feature manager changes based on what I have selected. So when I am in editing mode, it changes from being the history, right? So when I go back in and I grab one of these features and I say I want to edit the feature tree changes to be a property manager. This is really important. If you need to access that feature tree, notice that it's now in the graphics area. If I click this plus, the whole entire feature tree is now available to me right in the graphics panel. I'm going to go ahead and leave this as it was, and you can just take a look at the part there. One other thing that I notice a lot of students struggle with is that they get frustrated and they'll be double click on the toolbar. Notice that if you double click on the toolbar, it makes it float. This can be helpful if you're using multiple monitors to create more space in the graphics window, but it can also be kind of frustrating because you don't know what caused this to fly out. To put it back, to pin it back in place, click on the gray bar at the top where it says Command Manager and drag it over to the little arrow icon, and that redocks it. Just remember, if you double click on that toolbar, it's going to pop out, but to put it back, put it right back on top of that arrow. That's it for this video. In future videos, we'll talk about how to navigate specific features, how to build sketches, and build parts. Thanks for watching.